Welcome back to Looking at Hollywood. A poem. From Paris to a matinee, be it cinema or cabaret, we present our special guest of the day, the glamorous, curvaceous Corinne Calvet. Skippy Lowe, take it away.
Oh, could you believe it, Corinne? Paris, grew up in Paris.
Oh, yes.
Was it fun those days, looking back?
How could it be fun? It was a war. We were occupied by the Germans.
Okay, was it tough then?
It was frightening. It was very frightening. It was also kind of exhilarating because it was a beginning of existentialism in the fact of the real beginning.
Right.
Where Jean-Paul Sartre and Cocteau and Jean Arnaud were trying to find some kind of a system beliefs that could give hope to the young generation. Mm-hmm. You know, that's why they told them to all dress in black because everybody could dye everything that they had in black. Mm-hmm. You know, because there was no clothes at all. There was nothing. There was nothing. It was a good school of discipline.
Do you think about those days? Does it run through your mind? Because you're living in Beverly Hills and you're living here, you've been living here for a long time. Just like you're seeing on the news right now, what's happening?
Yes,
another concentration camp.
Exactly. It's the injustice. You know, the injustice of the world at this particular point is outrageous.
Right.
You know, this is a time where we have to become one. Uh-huh. We have to have unity. We have to have one world. We have to have one government. We have to have everybody get along to save this planet. We can no longer stay in a little corner and think that, I don't care, I'll do what I want, it's not going to affect anybody else. Because whatever we do is affecting everybody else.
Corinne Calvet, you're sitting there telling me we should all be loved and one. Do you actually think that's going to happen?
Well, I tell you something, Skippy.
We've been fighting for that for years and years and years.
For 16 years,
really?
I have done a therapy called metamorphosis therapy, in which, in 5 sessions, I turn people into human beings instead of just men or women. And I do that by giving them dominion over their negative thoughts and their negative feelings, so that they can be the programmer of their life. And once you get to realize that you can be the programmer of your life and you don't have to be the victim of the programming that your parents gave you, that society gave you, it's another ball game. Totally different ball game, you know?
Corinne Calvet.
Yes.
Studied at one of the finest French dramatic schools in the world. Theater.
Yes.
The best, Française.
La Comédie Française.
Oh, what a great school that is.
Yeah, it was.
How about you doing, looking back, studying
I was
there?
Doing, I was doing that at 14 years old. I had a very deep voice, you know.
You still do, darling.
So they made me play all the grandfathers. They stuck beard and moustache in it, and I played all the grandfathers, you know, in Molière and Racine and all the...
Did you enjoy that thesis? But you learned a lot.
I enjoyed having people silent and listening to what I have to say.
Oh.
It's one of my greatest pleasures in the world. In therapy, it's wonderful, you know, because the difference between my therapy and other people's therapy is that my client speaks for 20 minutes the first time.
And then
all the other sessions, I'm the only one that speaks. Because I am what we call a sensitive, you know. I can expand my heart in my mind, so that, for example, if I was doing it now, my heart would get bigger and bigger and bigger, and now the two of us would be sitting in one heart. When you do that, you're sitting in the heart of God.
Right.
And if you sit in the heart of God, I know everything that's going on within you.
You do?
Oh, absolutely.
Through my eyes or what?
No, darling.
Sensitive.
My heart is touching your heart. And I recognize you as a human being. So since all the emotion of the world have been programmed into our computers, if you're going for a certain emotion, it's going to tickle me in that particular position, and I'm going to know it. That's why I can do it very fast, you see. But then after that, because I go from the principle that if you hear something that you recognize, you don't have to go and find out how it came about.
True.
So you jump level every time, you jump level.
Corinne Calvet, came to America?
It's not really my name, you know?
It isn't your name, Corinne Covey?
No.
But when did you come to America and change that name then?
Well,
tell me about that.
My father, Comte Dubose de Mailly,
oui.
Pierre Dubose de Mailly, I was his youngest daughter. When he found out I wanted to go in show business, he said, please don't take the family name, because you're going to run into a complete lack of respect in that business.
Right.
So take another name. So I said, well, okay. And I took Calvey because it was available, it was there, and I saw it. But it was totally by accident that I took Calvey. My real name is Corinne Dubose de Mailly, Countess.
You're a countess?
Yeah.
A real countess?
I'm a real countess in my heart. Now, you see, in France, in Europe, the girls don't have the right to keep the title.
Oh, okay.
Only the boys.
Counts and stuff.
You know,
yeah.
But I don't pay attention to that. I was born a human being from a count, and I'm a countess. But
I'm a French countess? Real French countess. First film in America when you arrived, Corinne.
Yeah.
What was it? Who was it? With?
It was with Burt Lancaster, Paul Henreid, Sam Jaffe, Peter Lorre.
Oops.
That's extraordinary.
That sounds like a great movie. What was it?
Rope of Sand.
Oh.
It was a great. I mean,
Rope of Sand.
Yeah.
Yes. Remember that, Annie? Rope of Sand?
I don't think I've seen that.
Oh, it's a great film.
It has aged a little bit, but my performance hasn't. Because I've never been any different than I am now, you know?
Did you get under contract with the studio immediately you got here?
Well, no, it was very complex. I got under contract to one studio, and then I got... I couldn't get along with one person, and they canceled my contract, and I hang around, then I went to MGM, and then I got signed back at the same studio that I was before, but by another producer. It was a mess.
French.
My father was totally right. You know.
He was?
So, yeah, and it's only now that I have the security of who I am, that, you know, I've decided, well, you know, I may as well take my real name, and I'm going to be working.
Really?
I'm going to, yes.
See, what do you mean you're going to be working?
I stop.
You sit there so secure of yourself nowadays, Corinne.
Yes,
you
why
really
not?
Know yourself nowadays,
oh, absolutely.
Don't you?
I know what I'm going to be doing, too.
What are you ever going to do? Tell me.
I'm going to help as many people as possible to leave behind the negative world, you know.
A lot of
and
the
I'm
help, honey.
I'm going to go back into acting. I'm going to be working with Whit Thomas Company. You know, they have all the best thing on TV
right
now. And we're trying to find a piece of property for me. So I'm going to be doing that. I'm going to still be doing my therapy. And at this particular point, I'm not really afraid of anybody anymore. When I first came here, you know, all those big producers, all those people that could do something for me, used to frighten me.
Frighten you? Why should they frighten you? Because they wanted to go to bed with you because you're a hot French lady, darling.
Then at that time, they never imagined that a French woman could be, anything but, you know, some hot
Right. I want to show a clip right now from a movie that you did with Danny Kaye.
Okay.
This was at Columbia?
No. This was at 20th Century Fox. It's called On the Riviera.
Very good. On Riviera. Let's see this.
Should I roll that, Skippy?
Yeah, please, Annie. Would you roll that, honey? Thanks, sweetie. Thanks.
Maybe we were going to show another one first.
Think about it.
Good.
Good night, Captain.
Good night.
Will you excuse me?
Antoine just brought it over. Read it, Henri. For heaven's sake, read it.
Calm yourself, Philippe. Regret to advise Air Europa unable to execute contract for purchase of...
No.
And if a man answers?
That is my husband. He will take the message.
Very touching souffle, huh?
I beg your pardon?
You no good two-face. You the minute you think my back is
turned. Mademoiselle, you are making a mistake.
I'm not the one who makes mistakes.
Ah, but this time you are. Allow me to introduce myself. I am Capitaine Henri Durand, at your service.
Capitaine Henri Durand, do you expect me to believe...
You see, the mustache is real.
It's incredible. Oh, you've come to see Jacques. You're angry with him.
You do not wish me to be angry with him?
Oh, please, no.
Ah, I take it you are interested in him.
Very much.
Mademoiselle, you should not be interested in imitations. You have too much to offer yourself. A beautiful girl like you should have the real thing.
Capitaine Durand, are you making love to me?
But of course. What are you doing, my dear, after the show?
I have a previous engagement.
Perhaps I could persuade you to break it?
You probably could, but I'm not going to let you.
Tomorrow night? Well, then perhaps you will come to my villa Saturday evening.
Certainly not.
You misunderstand, my dear. We're having a large reception and the house will be filled with people.
Captain Durand, that's a very old one. I come and all the other guests, they fail to show up, eh?
It is my misfortune that they all will be there. But please come anyway. Here's my card.
Henri! Oh, Henri, this telegram, read it, it is urgent.
Yes, yes, just a moment.
Okay. Stand by.
Counting me in.
Oh, I forgot to show you my code.
16 minutes left into the program. Left it for the program.
Yeah, I know, but you're counting me in. Right.
We haven't shown the code of arm.
Hmm? Yeah, we're going to do that.
Okay, just leave. Three. Three, two...
Corinne, that accent, that French beautiful voice, it's a definite style. The only... When you hear that voice walking... when I used to go to the men's room, say I had to leave the theater to go to the men's room, I can walk back and I walk in, I can hear that voice. It's definite. Corinne Carvé?
Definitely.
It's a definite.
Yes. It was worked on by three different diction...
Right.
excuse me, codes. Uh-huh. And... they could not get me to put my tongue in the right place.
Oops, I beg your pardon.
I was very fond of the place where my tongue goes into when I speak French.
Uh-huh.
It has to go totally differently when you speak English.
Uh-huh.
I have a little cat.
Have some water, darling. It's very good. You were telling me something about, as a countess, you know, you're... Mm-hmm. A crown? You have a crown?
Oh, of course, yeah. I have my coat of arms. You want to see it?
Is this a coat of arms?
Yes.
Can the camera get that real close? Look at that coat of arms. It's beautiful.
Isn't it beautiful?
Yes, it really
it's
is.
It's got a leg on it.
Do you use it on your stationery now? On your letter writing and all that?
I am considering doing it.
Because you've hidden it away from the people in the world.
Well, I did because with the kind of role I was playing and with the kind of thing that was going on, I could not bring the countess in the business.
I understand.
And now that we're going to change the quality of the film that are going to be shown on television, because we suddenly have realized the damage we're doing to the young people.
Yes.
So now I can come in and I can admit who I am.
Danny Kaye, come on. Love Danny Kaye.
I love Danny Kaye.
Good. Was he fun to work with?
He was more than fun. He was like a total perfectionist.
Uh-huh.
Every move that he made, everything, perfect.
But you worked with the best. Corinne Galvin, coming to America, they put you with the best people. Jimmy Stewart, James Cagney, Danny Kaye, and you even married a movie star.
Joseph Cotton. Alan Ladd.
Come on, down the line. Alan Ladd, Joseph Cotton, good.
All of them.
Why did they make, because you were the only one at that time, French. Real sexy French.
Yeah, also it's because I have a lot of power on the screen. You
power.
Know?
What do you mean? I know you have power, but what do you mean by a lot of power on the screen?
I have a lot of love that is passing through me. You know, so the enthusiasm.
Ah, here we go that hard again.
Yeah, the enthusiasm to be in front of the world, to be acting, to be seen. That enthusiasm just, it's like a brilliant light, and it goes right through.
It does.
And when they did some tests, they say, well, wait a minute, you know, we have to put her against the guys that have the same kind of quality.
That's the secret, isn't it?
Yes.
In film.
Yes.
Marilyn Monroe had that same quality, didn't she?
Yeah. She was more languorous, you know, she was more like this. I was more like cute and, you know.
Dean Martin, you did movies with Dean and Jerry Lewis. They loved you.
I did two movies with them.
Working with Jerry Lewis and Dean Martin together.
Working with Dean Martin was a great, great joy.
Jerry Lewis, you're not saying. She said Dean.
I still, to this day, I don't understand why the French are so much in love with him.
Really?
It frightens me to go back to France if that's a humor that they like.
Uh-huh.
Because this is a humor that is so Americanized, Brooklyn, very, you know, it's kind of, I never could understand it. Uh-huh. I was never attracted to it.
Uh-huh.
And now, if the French are wanting to get that kind of humor, I don't want to go back.
Charlie Chaplin? They consider him Charlie Chaplin?
No,
consider him Charlie Chaplin of America, darling. Don't they, Annie, would you say?
Chaplin was never vulgar.
No, I'm not saying that. But
I think Jerry has a certain amount of gestures and things that are kind of vulgar.
Well, he's guilty now because that's why he's doing his thing once a year for the
muscular dystrophy telethon.
I think that's why he feels guilty, because he used to work that way on stage, didn't he? When he started.
No, he has no.
Yes, he did. He used to. All that.
Jerry has no guilt.
He doesn't have guilt?
No.
I just think that's a cause he feels very strongly about.
He's totally capable.
I understand that, but
he's totally capable of being that clown. I am not judging the fact. I think he's a great actor.
Right.
I think he's fantastic. I think he's a big star. Huh. It's just happened that his kind of humor don't touch me.
I see.
You know.
Okay, this humor touches you. I think this is going to be James Cagney. This is a great actor. This is a great American actor working with James Cagney. We'll talk about it. Let's show this clip of you and James Cagney in a film called
What Price Glory?
What Price Glory? Remember that, Annie?
Oh,
I want you to show that clip. It is a great movie. This is Warner Brothers?
No.
No?
This Jimmy is 20th Century Fox
was
again.
Was he a 20th Jimmy at the time?
No,
they worked at Oliver? Okay, let's show it.
Okay.
What, baby?
What are you doing in my room?
I've been looking over your metal collection.
Ah, that's nothing. But you must go back to your room.
Yeah, in a minute. Captain Flagg. Hiya, Charmaine. I got almost everything packed. Will you want your long underwear in Paris? No, shove off, lame brain.
Dennis, you're going to Paris?
Yeah.
Take me with you.
Oh, I can't. It's impossible.
Why?
Well, it's a very big, important meeting. They're going to be asking me a lot of questions.
You?
Yeah, they want the point of view of an observer from up front. Get out of here, will you? Get out.
All right.
Well, I've observed much. I'd be glad to tell them.
Yeah, I know, but I can't. You see, your father wouldn't like it. What would he think about it?
Papa. Well, Papa, he would be very glad if you would marry me and take me with you to Paris.
Marry you?
No.
No, it's impossible, Charmaine. I'd like to, but I can't. You see, I'm married already.
You're a terrible liar.
Oh, no, I'm not. I'll prove it to you. Wait. Oh, here. Here's the picture. Picture of my wife right here. There it is.
Lillian Russell.
Yeah, that was our maiden name.
Sweet Caporal.
Oh, Sweet Corporal. You see, I was a corporal when she married me. That's what you always called me. Always called me. Yeah. Her sweet corporal.
Captain Flagg, is it important?
Oh, he told it was over sooner than he thought.
That's okay, darling.
So
you'll let me know. Just count me in.
That was a great scene.
Get ready to roll. Tape's rolling. 3, 2.
God, Jimmy Stewart, working with Jimmy Stewart and James Cagney. James Cagney happens to be one of the greatest actors.
Very difficult man to work with.
Was he?
Very difficult, because he kept you on your toes. He never rehearsed the same way that he did a take.
That's not difficult. You know why difficult? Because you're learning something from him. That's good.
Wait a minute. Yeah. Wait a minute.
Go ahead.
Because if you tune yourself to somebody else,
right?
Okay, and they rehearse, then you're tuned in to what they do. If suddenly they change,
oh,
their attitude and their reaction, they are getting the upper hand on you.
I see.
And he would change after a free shot, you know, because he always thought that the third or the fourth shot is what the director was going to take. But I'm up to that. Mm. You know, I wasn't, you know, I could always
Corinne,
keep it up with him.
Corinne Calvet, you married a hot, hot actor. Annie, believe me, he was a wonderful actor. And a wonderful hot guy. You certainly did. Who was that? Come on, that beautiful guy in San Pedro.
I married beautiful men, but they were not tremendous actors.
One was. Which one was that one I'm thinking of? The good actor. And he's a hot guy. Come on, Corinne. You're gonna hide it from me now, darling. It's in San Pedro.
No, because at this point
what's his name?
Well,
there was John Bronfield.
Stop. Robert Fontaine.
Let's go with John Bronfield first, and then we'll get Robert Fontaine.
No, we don't get them.
You don't like to talk about your men?
No, not at all.
Really? Did you have bad marriages or what?
No, I always married men that could be with me.
Could be with you?
Yeah. 24 hours a day.
Oh, they weren't with you 24 hours a day?
Yes, I'd like that.
Oh, okay.
But that also meant that they were not successful on their own that much.
Ah.
Do you understand?
So you like successful men.
Well, I did.
Was Corinne a hot lady around Hollywood those days? Because you had a home, you had parties. Every night, I understand, you had parties at your home.
I had the most important people in the world come in for this house. I had what we call, in the old days, we used to call it a salon.
So,
you know,
yes.
Where we brought people, scientists, poets, musicians, all together and mixed them.
Right. That's a party. Mm-hmm. That's Hollywood party.
It was,
really.
But never that many, you know, always no more than 20 people. So everybody could sit at the table for dinner and, you know, it was really very elegant.
Let's go back.
What?
One night. Who was the most exciting night at the party you had at your party? Because you've thrown so many.
I don't really think I want to talk about it, because it would be putting my computer back there, and I'm so much living
you
in, wanna,
you
in
like
the
to
present.
Live in the present,
right,
don't you?
Now.
See,
right,
Corinne
now.
Doesn't like to live in the past.
No.
What made Corinne Calvet get into this wonderful thing you're doing
hypnotherapy.
Now? Hypnotherapy. Yes. What made you
Metamorphosis
get
therapy.
Well,
I use hypnosis, but it's a metamorphosis, you know, because I take people that are inside their cocoon of their fear
okay.
and their trouble, and I just burst it open so they can fly out like butterfly. That's
okay.
what I do.
I like to fly like a butterfly, too.
could I work on you, baby?
I bet you can.
He's ready to fly, believe me. He's ready to fly.
As crazy as I am, I bet.
Well, I went around and studied with all the spiritual masters that came to this country. Because, you know, instead of going to shop on Rodeo Drive, that never was attractive to me. So I went and shopped and saw all the new things that were happening spiritually. And the one thing that always amazed me is that those people were not affected by their surrounding. They had a peace of mind that was extraordinary, and I wanted that.
I see.
So I studied with them, and while I was with them, it was okay, because you're totally protected from the world. Mm-hmm. But as soon as you go outside in the world, boom, you get back into be affected negatively. So I got a computer, and I find out, as soon as I got the computer, I realized that God created man in his image, and man created the computer in the image of his intellect.
Right.
So if you program like a code word into the computer, every time you say that code word, you are going to have the action happen automatically.
Right.
So what I do is that we see that the conscious mind is a biocomputer of your intellect, of all your thought, and that the subconscious mind is a computer of all your feelings, of all your emotion, and we program two code words in those computer, and every time you say those code words, you eliminate all negative feeling and negative thought out of the screen of your consciousness.
Right.
When you do that, you are in the moment, you are at peace, and you don't get affected by anything that is going on around you.
It's difficult.
No.
It's difficult to be in the moment.
I do that in one session.
In one session?
One session, you're in control of your computer.
How do people contact you? How do people know and get to know Karen Calvé? You're a movie star. Aren't you afraid to meet somebody? Because if you give your number out,
yeah,
aren't you? You're not afraid.
No. How no, I'm not afraid because I don't. People have to know somebody to recommend me. By example,
right.
People are going to call
I
your
see,
show.
I see.
And then I talk to them on the telephone.
I see.
And I can judge in the telephone if they're a mass murderer or if they are somebody that is lost and want to find their own spiritual being.
Looking back over Corinne's passage life, had a good time?
I had more than a good time. I had a terrible time.
Terrible?
I had an exhilarating time. I had a painful time. I had a joyous time. I had a sexy time. I had adventures that was extraordinary. I probably have had 6 or 7 life in this lifetime.
Whoops. What was the most extraordinary thing in Corinne's life? Time right now?
I think it was making love in Hercules Grotto in Tangier, outside of Tangier, in a cave that supposedly Hercules went and hid it during the storm. And there was a magnificent stone there. And my husband and I conceived our son on that stone.
Oh. Is this Fontaine?
Yeah.
John Fontaine?
Robert Fontaine.
Robert Fontaine. Yeah.
And he's always been very special. And I don't think that experience I ever had again.
Uh-huh.
The god of Mount Olympus were there with us. It was extraordinary.
She felt
good. Only one child. Yeah, she has only one child. One child.
I adopted another child.
You adopted?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, really? Your ex-husband lives in Penang. I remember because I was
the father of my child.
Your father of your child, the one you carried on with in this
Grotto Circle.
Yes, I met him, I met him in Penang. I was in Malaysia working.
He's a charming man, isn't he?
I was working with Margie McGlory and all those wonderful people at the American military shows. I was working Joni James and all these wonderful. And we were working in the Far East from Vietnam, and I went to Penang, and there he is, this American man, and he was the first one I met at the hotel.
Charming. You know, he was the original person that they did Sleeping Beauty with.
Uh-huh.
You know, the designer at Disney?
Yes.
I mean, they shot the scene, and then the designer, you know, do all the design.
Yeah. Does Corinne... Go ahead.
Sorry.
No, does Corinne Calvé have a favorite movie that she did?
No.
No favorite?
No.
How about a favorite leading man?
No.
You have no favorite leading man?
No. The favorite movie... I am so ambitious with my talent that I've not even been seen yet. You know,
you
because
more
the French,
go.
The French little tart and the la 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 Swiss, you know that. But I have something else inside to express.
You never really were la 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 la. That was all acting. But basically, like you said, you don't like to go to Rodale and shop. Corinne Calvé is a very. Lonely and very.
No.
You're together.
I am not.
You're not lonely. But okay.
I've chosen to live alone.
That's what I mean.
That's not lonely, darling.
You enjoy being by yourself.
There's so very few people I enjoy to be with.
It's because you enjoy yourself.
Well, because I appreciate myself and what's going on around me, and I can go to any restaurant and get the best table and have a wonderful time by myself. You know, I can hear the music of the wind in the trees. I can look at people. I can also see people suffering and send them a wave of love.
Do you have a man in your life, Corinne Calvé?